James Holder for IFL TV in association with Matt King's Jim Mark Bauer. I'm in Liverpool side at the Hilton, just had the press conference. With me, I've got WBC title changer Tony Bellew. How are we doing?
How are you, mate?
Almost forgot who you was then for a minute.
That's the first time for everything.
I'm telling you.
I'm happy the Kung Fu Panda's not behind the camera this time.
Well, he's having a little day's break, isn't he? Day's rest. We've overworked him.
Mate, his whole life's a break. He's always on a break, that fella. Jesus Christ. He doesn't know what work was, but slapped him in the face, him.
That's harsh, Tony.
You've got to be cruel to be kind.
Indeed. Let's talk a little bit about your movie star career.
So you've gone kind of...
I would say Hollywood, but it weren't Hollywood, was it?
Oh, no. It was Philadelphia. It's going to be a Hollywood movie, like, but...
Yeah.
You know, we'll see. Let's just... You know, if the movie comes across the way the director, Ryan Coogler, wants to come across it, it'll be an amazing movie. Ryan Coogler's an amazing director. Yeah. He made an amazing movie called Fruitvale Station in 20 days with one camera, so it's a testament to how good of a director this kid is. He's an outstanding person. And, you know, along with the cast that he put together for the movie, you know, your Sylvester Stallone, your Michael B. Jordan, your Graham McTavish's, there's Tessa Thompson, there's so many great actors in the movie that it was a pleasure to be a part of.
What was it like when the ADs would come up and be like, "Ah, oh, Tony, we need you, Tony, we need you here, Tony"?
It was crazy, mate.
Was it, like?
It was nuts. It was a lot of days of filming. I think it was... 40 days of filming while I was there. It was a lot of movie time, and making movies is a lot of the time spent around doing nothing. And you know, Hollywood, what they like to call it, is not what it's made out to be. I think it's Hollyweird is more appropriate, to be honest.
I mean, last time we saw you out, points decision against Nathan Cleverley,
yes.
That quite didn't live up to expectations of yourself and probably Nathan as well. Looking back on that now, are you sort of just...
Definitely not, man.
Period's over?
I'm happy I beat him, and beat him clearly. The one thing I will say is I came and gave the best, you know, I could possibly give on the night, considering, you know, what he done. I think it was absolutely criminal to say he was going to fight me and I couldn't beat him and I couldn't outwork him, or, you know, I think it was criminal what he done. And then to go in there and to fight someone like Sergei Kovalev head on and then run from me, or lie on the ropes and keep your hands up like pillows around your head against me, was just criminal. And I think, you know, he single-handedly robbed the fans of a good fight, because it was, look back at the fight, you know, listen, the fight is not actually that bad when you watch it back, what people are saying, but I am the first to admit that it didn't live up to the expectation, but that was not because of me. I came to fight, I pressed all night. Let's remember, I pinned that guy to a ropes for the last four rounds of that fight to take the decision. I never believed in a million years he was going to run. I was under the influence that this guy fought Sergei Kovalev head on. He's not going to fear fighting Tony Bellew head on. Well, it's pretty obvious, as the Sergei Kovalev defeat made him so wary of getting into a fight that he could get knocked out again. And I believe I clipped him with the slightest of left hooks on the chin in the second round. And I just believe he thought in his mind, unless this guy falls apart and absolutely tires dreadfully, then I'm just going to keep my hands up and throw the jab, and that's it. He would not throw right hand. He went into his change room after the fight and informed Ambrose Mendy there was nothing wrong with his right hand. So, you know, it's very disappointing, and it's heartbreaking, to be honest, because that should have been a platform for me to really go on to the bigger things. And instead, I was slated and castrated by fans and by media, by journalists. But I urge you to go and look at the fight and watch the man who's making a fight of it, who's trying to make a fight of it, and watch a man who's basically just trying to survive. The best way I can put it is you've got some of your best prospects in the world facing journeymen, guys who are like 25 and 6 or something like that, real surviving journeymen. Now, I've seen world-class journeymen survive with amazing world-class fighters. Now, fancy trying to beat a world-class, former world champion, who's in defensive journeyman mode, to try and beat someone like that. Now, if Paul Bonson can go the distance with some world-class fighters, I think it's pretty evident that Nathan Cleverley, when he puts his mind to it, can go the distance with anybody he wanted to, if he chose to. If he would have fought Kovalev the way he fought me, it would have gone 12 rounds and he'd have lost. So, you know, and I think that's the lesson that he learned the most. Oh, it's a very disappointing, you know, long gone are the days where he would put his hands down and give you his chin and rattle his face around. There was no sign of that with me. It was very disappointing.
Do you think when a fighter is on the wrong end of a brutal knockout, then sometimes maybe they lose their confidence and that kind of...
I don't think he'd have lost his confidence if he was facing someone else but me. I just think the thought of getting knocked out by me would have been, oh no, it can never go away. Or I don't think he'll fight Jürgen Bremer like that.
I was just going to come to this point.
I don't think he'll fight Jürgen Bremer like that. I really don't. And I really do believe he's got a chance of beating Jürgen Bremer too.
I know you're in the Tony Bellew business, and yes, not the Nathan Cleverley business, but do you think he's made the right decision to drop back down the way? In your opinion?
No, because he's a cruiserweight athlete. He's an amazing athlete, so how can you go from being an amazing athlete losing to a fat guy, I'm just going by his words, and then going on to, you know, to, oh, I'm not big enough at the weight, but just last week he was an amazing athlete, son. So, you know, you can't have it. You know, you can't have it both ways. It's either one way or the other. Are you a cruiserweight or are you not? You know, he told the world and anybody who would listen that he was an amazing athlete. It just so turns out that, you know what, the fat guy was the amazing athlete because he's the guy who didn't stop working in the fight. The other guy lied on ropes and put the earmuffs on. So, you know, I'm done with talking about him, to be honest. You know, he's got his career, I've got mine. The main thing is, from day one, I always wanted that rematch, and I told anybody who would listen that I would beat him, and I beat him a lot clearly in the rematch than the first fight ever was. And I think it's quite apparent now why the first fight was as close as it was. So I'm happy I've got the monkey off my back, and it's on to bigger and better things now.
Indeed. You're back fighting on the 24th against Sudor, is that right?
Nothing, yeah, Lubos Sudor.
Nothing so. Really more than just to get you out and get you back tuned
up. It is, but I can't really take fights like that, to be honest, James. What I've got to do is, you know, this guy's got 33 wins on his resume and against 9 losses, so he's a winner. He hasn't beat 33 people by luck, and I'm just looking forward to, you know, getting in there and testing myself against them. You know, listen, I'm not saying he's a world beater because I'm not a liar, but what I will say is he's beat 33 men and he's knocked out 20 plus of them. So, you know, it's a fight at the end of the day, and it's one I'll prepare well for as usual. It's the first 10 rounder in my career. You know, people forget that since my 12th professional fight, I've had title fights, and every single fight since my 12th professional fight has been a title fight. That's a lot of 12-week camps. That's a lot of training and work gone into them fights. You know, I don't know many people who have had 15, 12-round fights on the spin. You know, usually guys have warm-ups, comebacks. No, not me. Just straight in for another title. So, you know, I'm looking forward to the 26th.
How much have you missed boxing? Obviously, I know in America you've been kind of doing boxing activities, if you like. You're keeping yourself fit, ticking
It's
over.
A lot better taking pretend punches to the face than it is real ones, let me tell you that. But ultimately, I'll be honest, mate, I've missed boxing real bad. I love fighting. Yeah. I said in the press going for, I love fighting. I love having a fight with someone. I don't know what it is that's in me, whether it's a sickness or a gene. I just love having a fight. I love the one-on-one combat. I love the fact that I can hurt someone and they can hurt me. And I just had a little fighting. It's the only way I can explain it, mate. I've missed it real bad. As you know, I didn't really do boxing training. I did lifted a lot of weights and done a lot of cardio training. And then when it came to the fight scenes, we done, you know, everything is very choreographed, and you know exactly. You know, you try remembering a choreographed fight for 12 rounds. It's a lot of hard work. 12-hour days, 16-hour days sometimes. It was amazing to be part of.
With the relationship Matchroom have got with Sauerland, obviously we see Nissa Sauerland here today.
Yes.
Do you think that makes the possibility of a world title fight against Juan Pablo Hernandez more likely?
Oh, it's happening. It's happening. It's sooner or later it's happening, mate. That's the best thing I could say. I've been on record and saying for a number of times, I believe he's the best fighter in the division. He's the most difficult fighter to beat in the division. And you know, I've just got this thing about wanting to face the best fighters like a big dope instead of I should just fight some clown for some other kind of title that gets made up, you know what I mean? It sends me down the twist. But listen, I'm a bit of a historian when it comes to boxing, and I believe in fighting the best guys and then saying, you know, listen, the day I become world champion, I promise you, I'm going to get on top of that Radio City Tower. I'm going to scream it from the roof. I'm the best cruiserweight in the world. And, you know, I don't believe that beating anyone else, but Juan Pablo Hernandez allows me to do that. So that's why I face the guys I face. You know, at the end of the day, who wants to face a 6'4" southpaw who can punch a bit as well? No one wants to do that. So I'm willing to do it. I'm going to do it. And you know, I'm going to implement a game plan with my coach and my team of how I'm going to pull that off. Mission Impossible.
Where is Caldwell today?
Dave has been non-stop, mate. Dave needs to chill, spend some time with his family. He's a fantastic coach. He's been a friend of mine for nearly a decade, Dave, and he's a good person, a good friend of mine, like I say. So, you know, I told him, listen, if I said to him, Dave, I want you to either be near the drop of a hat, but I told him, stay at home, relax. We've been away from our families for 2.5 weeks.
Yeah.
I've been away from my family previous to that for 2 months, from my family, sorry. And, you know, you need time with your family and you need to recuperate and refresh and then come back with a hunger and a desire to want to perform in the gym. Me and Dave perform really well in the gym together. He gets the best out of me. He's a hard taskmaster. He's a great trainer, a good person, a good man. And, you know, he's always been there from when I've needed him. You know, Dave Caldwell is someone, like I say, who I can trust, and I've been around him a long, long time.
Well, I don't know what the Yanks have done. You don't seem as passionate as normal. Is the passion still burning strong?
Oh, mate, the passion is burning strong. I just want to fight. I just want to fight. I've just missed fighting so much.
Yeah.
It's just been so long, so it's going to take a little time to build back up. But, you know, the harder the training gets over these next few weeks, I think the more intense you'll see me get. And like I say, I've just missed fighting so much. I miss boxing. I like being around boxing, you know. I love talking about boxing. I love explaining about boxing. I hated Las Vegas, but I loved being around amazing fighters and being in Las Vegas and talking and interviewing with fighters. I got to see Andre Ward, who I worked with in the movie. So, you know, it's just nice. I like being around boxing. I like being around boxing people, mate. I love it. So long may it continue.
It's not a bad life when you're calling one of the pound-for-pound greats, Dre. Not a bad life.
Yeah, it's mad, mate. He's a cool guy. You know, I spent quite a bit of time with him in Philly. On the movie set, he's part of the movie, so you know, just tune in November the 25th, Thanksgiving in US, and see the movie. The movie's going to be really, really good, Creed, and just watch and enjoy.
Top man. Tony, I can't thank you enough for your time. Thank you, sir.
Always a pleasure, mate. Stay tuned in.